Hello and welcome to Schein Chats. I'm Dr. Gary Severance, professional leader of Henry Schein, and today I'm very excited to be joined by Michelle Strange, who is a hygienist, not only a registered dental hygienist, but has her master's in dental hygiene. And she's the co-founder and co-host of a podcast, A Tale of Two Hygienists, and also the co-founder of Level Up Infection Prevention. Michelle, it's so good to have you here today. And I want to say, I know you're taking the rest of the year to travel around the United States and check out dentistry and volunteer, which is so noble to see what's changed. So we're excited about the conversation. But where do we find you today?
I am still in Charleston, South Carolina for one more day.
One more day. Well, great to have you here. What we want to do is kind of go across how dentistry has changed. And for the most part, the better due to the pandemic. We've all focused on new things in dentistry, maybe we took for granted. But we also know that dentistry was probably the best prepared of any medical profession for what happened. But I think we've gotten even better.
Yeah.
And I know you speak on that very often, so it'll be great to hear your ideas of what has changed for the better in dentistry. Let's touch on the sterilization and infection control standard operating procedures for instrumentation. And how has that evolved and taken its sense of a turn?
Well, I think we're talking about it. We actually are creating standard operating procedures. And I think that's the biggest change. Like, if we are truly talking about the workflow of our sterilization center. We're talking about it to our patients because they are very aware and they want to know. And I hope what is happening out there is that we are highlighting all the things that we're doing in the steri center or the sterilization area, that we don't just breeze by it and like, yep, and there's where we do, you know, our instrument cleaning or whatever some people say that make it seem like, oh, just, you know, in another area. Like, no, these are the things we're doing to keep you safe. And I think the fact we're talking about it has been the biggest change.
Yeah, and assigning specific tasks so everybody knows what they should be doing at the same time. So it's a lot of paying attention. And we may have already always had those standard operating procedures, but I think we're paying closer attention. And you're absolutely right. Walking through an office for the first time or even a return visit, you're getting a tour of the entire office because it's on the back of the minds of all the patients.
Exactly.
And also in this pandemic time, we learned new definitions, right? We learned what doffing and donning was, which I had never really considered before. But then a little known fact, I found out the definition goes back to do on, donning, and do off, doffing. So it makes it very clear. I didn't, but it's very clear. But we also learned about what categories of aerosol generating procedures there are. And although that dates back to the 90s and some of the premier definitions, we never worried about it. But we also really focused on high volume evacuation and knowing that 97% of the aerosols are captured in the mouth. But now in your profession, specifically with hygiene, there was an emphasis on high volume evacuation, whether it was in the mouth or just outside the mouth. Can you share a little bit on how that has changed and the highlights of dentistry?
We have options. We actually have options, and that is exciting. And I selfishly feel very excited about this because I was talking about this really in 2019 going like, we have got to figure out how to use our HVE. I mean, it is the best standard of practice. It keeps us safe. It keeps our patients safe. But, you know, there's not a lot out there. And what's out there is cumbersome. It messes with our ergonomics. It's either like I'm hurting my wrist or slapping my patient in the face with the tubing. Like, these were my options. And now I have a plethora of, you know, these engineering controls to choose from to either work within my ergonomic capabilities. You know, it's truly getting to the point where, you know, in ergonomics, they talk about adapting the tools to the user. And for so long, we were adapting the user to the one HVAC that we had, our HVE that we had. So now we can truly adapt the tools to our needs and our system and how many units we have going. And I mean, there's so much. And we're talking about it. We're actually talking about aerosol management in an office.
Absolutely. And I think even chairside dental assistants really refocused on being able to be in the right spot at the right time to capture all that as well. And certainly hygiene now getting more of a four-handed, whether it's a machine sitting next to the patient or, you know, using the new tools. And manufacturers, I think, have done a great job of inventing new products to meet the needs. So they're coming slowly by slowly, and all advantages. One big area also in the dental operatory that is often unfortunately overlooked, but certainly makes a big impact in the whole patient care and safety of the dental team, is waterlines. The reimportance of looking at the waterlines. And I know you have strong instruction and opinions on the use of devices to monitor, but also to make sure everything is copacetic.
Well, yeah, I mean, so right before the pandemic hit, we were about to see the court cases finalized from Anaheim and the children who were very ill and hospitalized, and also the ones in Georgia. And so we were really kind of getting after, like, talking about testing, shocking, and maintaining your dental unit water lines, and how important it is to run those lines on a regular basis, because we have a real dirty secret in the industry, and that's the dirty dental unit water lines. And now, I think when we all shut down and our little water bottles and our water lines and all of our hand pieces and stuff just sat there, we all came back to going, oh, what has been growing in these things? And we, I know personally, I had to go in and shock lines a few times. We wanted under 500 CFUs because that's acceptable drinking water. And so it took me quite a few shocks to do that. And now we're in a rhythm of maintaining it. But I don't think a lot of people even had a clue that was something that they had to prepare for before they even opened back up. And man, I think all of us learned really quick how to clean those water lines.
And I think what really is focused is the entire office, whether in infection control, the patient coming in and touching the counter, the doorknob, the magazines in the front office, they have to know about it. And maybe didn't even the air that is recirculated through the office. So I think dentistry has really stepped up. Final question is, and the CDC came back and talked about fallow time and the time between the patients, right? Which you never have enough of for your profession or changing patients. And actually, when you look up follow time, the definition is a time when very little is being achieved. So we know that's not true. In dentistry, it's the time between patients, but that's really when everything becomes corrected, right? Between patients. That, how has that changed for you, for the patients, and for you and the profession?
I think this is going to be an unpopular opinion, but I think we do not get enough time between patients for never have we. And so when the CDC said that we needed to have that 10 to 15 minute time for everything to kind of settle, you saw everybody kind of panic and freak out and like, go, I don't have time. Like, we've been closed. We need to see patients. And when I did have it, I was like, oh my gosh, this is so great. I can go write up my charts. I can write up my notes. I can make sure everything is documented. And then I can get in there and truly do the operatory turnover with the proper disinfecting like time and kill time and contact time. I can wait until things dry so I can barrier wrap properly. It was wonderful. It really was. So I do encourage everybody to time themselves when they're doing environmental infection control and their operatory turnover to make sure that you are giving yourself enough time between patients, that you are as a team aware of the contact time and the kill time of your disinfectants. And if you don't have the time, really go look at barrier wraps because they can save you in that turnover time. So, yeah.
Michelle, thank you so much for joining us today. Good luck in the travels and your volunteering to find out more about what dentistry is doing across the United States and maybe even into Canada if you venture that way. So again, thank you, the viewers, for tuning in to Schein Chats. We look forward to the next conversation. Thank you, Michelle.
Thank you.